everyone. I believe it is Wednesday, 4 p.m. I am very excited. We have a new show that will be starting next week, but I thought this week we'll just bring on a couple of the guys. It is John Kim and Joe Tehan, and I think we're bringing back a show that used to be called Cash Plays. I think John Kim at one point was a host of the show, and I'm sure you guys all know him. He's an amazing cash game player. I'm looking at the winnings that he has compared to Tehan, and I'm going to see if those guys have some trash talk between the two of them. There's a huge number difference there. Tehan's almost at $4 million total in tournament winnings, and John Kim has just broken into the $300,000. So obviously, John Kim is the cash game player, and Joe Tehan is the tournament player. So it's going to be interesting to see what these guys are going to bring to the table. They have a site they work on together called Stack'em Coaching, and this show is brought to you by Stack'em Coaching. So why don't we bring on John Kim right now?
Hello.
Hi, John. How's it going?
Hey, good.
Good. Just was telling all of our listeners that there's a huge difference between you and Mr. Tehan in tournament winning, so I'm guessing you're the cash game player.
Yeah, but that's not fair to Joe, too, because even though he's known for tournaments, they don't know his cash game prowess, and he's done really well for himself in live cash games.
Nice. Yeah, that's one of those things that the live cash games, there isn't really a DB for live cash games, is there?
No, there isn't. Well, online they have the tracking sites, so people kind of get a general idea of who's doing what in cash games.
Okay, well, listen, I'm going to give him a call right now.
Okay.
He's going to be joining us via phone, and like I just told everyone, this is sort of just an introductory to the show that's going to be starting next week, and I'm really excited, man. This is going to be a lot of fun.
Yeah, we're excited, too.
Let's see if we can't connect with Mr. Tehan.
Hello.
Hey, Mr. Tehan, welcome to your own show, sir.
Oh, hey, what's up?
How's it going? I was just remarking to Mr. Kim that you definitely, on paper, are the tournament player out of the two of you.
Oh, to John, yeah.
He's a tournament luck box, that's what he is.
Come on. I mean, if that's what it takes, yeah, I'm the tournament luck box between the two of us.
I see.
I think John, he should be playing more tournaments, though. I don't know why he doesn't.
It's not like you haven't had success at the tournaments you have played, Mr. Kim. What are you planning on playing more tournaments this year at the World Series?
Yeah, I mean, World Series, I always play a lot of tournaments. I think I played 20-some events last year. Generally, I do play quite a few during the World Series, but rest of the year, I focus on cash game. It's just more stable, just provides more stability.
Sure. And Joe, you and John was just saying that, you know, you're not known as much for being a cash game player, but you sure do pick up some money when you do play. What games do you like to play when you do play cash?
What I like to play versus what I normally do play is kind of different. I like to play mixed games. I love playing the mixed games. It's just usually there's not enough around. If I go down to like LA, I'll play like some higher stakes mixed games. But it's just they're few and far between, and I don't get to play them quite as much. My kind of normal game is either like 5-10 or some sort of 5-10 PLO or something along those lines.
Got it. And how about you, John? What do you play when you play cash?
Nowadays I mix between live and online. Pre-Black Friday is mostly like 80% online. So around the mid-stakes, 2-4 to 5-10 online. But 5-10 is kind of considered high stakes nowadays online. No, and live, anywhere from 2-5 to 10-20. And I've played as high as 100, 200 an L. And Joe's played higher, too. He plays 10-20.
Yeah, I mean, I wish I could play higher, but it's kind of I moved away from Vegas. So I don't really have... You know, sometimes the option, you know, you don't have quite the options that you used to. I mean, I moving away from Vegas, I can't play as big as I used to play, which I kind of regret that, but.
But where did you move to?
I mean, I moved to Carpinteria, California. I'm still like 50-50. I spend some time in Vegas, but.
Right.
Yeah, I've been spending a lot more time out here, so. I can't quite play as big as I'd like to play, but.
Got it. So
it's still plenty good enough for me.
So you guys have started Stack'em Coaching. Why don't you kind of tell us a little bit about that? I mean, we'll get into it. I mean, you guys got a really good list of players that you have on that, students, and I think the model you guys are doing is a lot different than other training sites out there. So why don't you, one of you guys, take a pick, either John or Joe. You know, tell us a little bit about Stack'em Coaching and what we can expect from the site and, you know, all that good stuff.
Okay. Yeah, I'll briefly talk about it.
Yeah.
We just thought there might be a niche for live poker. It's never really been covered. All the training sites online is geared for online poker, right? So there's nothing out there for live poker players, especially after Black Friday, where some online players had to transition to live, like myself. We thought, you know, there might be more of a demand for it. And there's probably, probably was always a demand for it because, you know, there's most people in America play more live than online. So even though on 2+2 it may not seem like it in the online forums, but majority of poker players are live players. And we just thought for people that want to improve their games, we can offer a product where they can actually do that. So, and
yeah. Yeah, and I think yeah. Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, I think like what John is saying, I mean, what if, you know, it's people who really want to like work on their games and improve their games. I mean, John and I both really wanted to, you know, we've been playing poker for a while and we wanted to help out other people who, like, you know, were trying to get better at the game. And plus we enjoy, like, just discussing poker and working with it and helping others, you know, so, or discussing theory with others, things like that. So it's really, like, geared towards people who want to get, who want to, like, improve their games.
A couple of things, too. We thought we can bring a couple of added elements because Joe and I have been longtime grinders. We've been around the poker scene for quite a while. We're not like the internet kids. You know, we don't pop up 2-3 years ago. Joe's been around 7-8 years. I'm going on year 14. And we made our living exclusively from poker and have done well. And we thought we can share some of that experience of just how to make it as a professional poker player if this is the road you choose to. And the other thing is, poker coaching is very expensive. If you check out like the marketplace and just individual coaching, I mean, they charge upwards of $500-$600 an hour.
Sure.
So we wanted to try to provide an affordable type of poker coaching. So kind of like a monthly subscription where you can listen in on real live poker coaching.
Yeah, and I think another thing that you guys have done a little different too is you've actually showcased your students. And when I click on the student tab, the first one I see is Jared Huggins, who's a great guy. And, you know, you guys have a really colorful list of students that you're actually, you know, you're putting out there for everybody to go look on the site that who your actual students are, right?
Yeah, that's correct.
Yeah, exactly. You know, we put out some students, you know, with good personalities, but they're, you know, they're trying to get better at poker. So, yeah, we just pretty much recorded our sessions with them, our coaching sessions with them for everyone else to listen to.
And we try to find guys or people with varying skill, different skill levels, so we don't have the same type of student as well. Like Stacy is mostly just a tournament player, like a live tournament player.
Right. Okay.
Yeah, and there were a couple other players. You know, we had some cash game players and some low stake players and high stake players. You know, so it's just different for everyone and any kind of thing you're looking for.
And actually, I guess this is kind of like a brag or whatever you want to call it. but pretty much all of our students have said our coaching has improved their game by miles, and some of them have much better win rates since they've received coaching. So I would think the advice, even if people are listening in, would be pretty invaluable.
No, and I think really, guys, what I see the trend here is that, you know, like you guys said before, you guys aren't new kids on the block, no pun intended there, but you guys are really helping, you know, people that were really affected by Black Friday transition to live play. Is that a trend that I'm seeing?
Yep, that's correct. But it's not just transitioning from online to live. It's just even live poker players in general. Your typical 1-2, 1-3 to 2-5 players. Most of them just, you know, play for fun or just want to make some money, and they struggle to do so. So we're trying to help, you know, like everybody in live poker that want to get better.
I understand, and I know that Joe, you've had great success playing in live tournaments. What's probably one of your biggest, you know, the biggest victory you've had and the best memory from playing live tournament poker?
Oh man, I mean, You know, anytime you win the tournament, it doesn't matter. For me personally, like, obviously the money's nicer in the big ones, but it doesn't matter if I win, like, a $100 tournament or a 10K tournament. I think the excitement of just winning a tournament is, like, it's just really second to none. I mean, that's kind of why everyone plays the game. It's for that rush. I guess my most exciting one was probably when I won Mandalay Bay WPT.
Right.
I don't know. That was probably because that was my biggest score. So, I mean, that was my most exciting one, I would have to say. But anytime you win a tournament, I think it's the same rush, regardless of the buy-in. Although a few weeks later, you're happier, I'm sure, with the bigger ones.
What's the deepest you've went into a WSOP?
I final tabled like two WSOP events. Last year I final tabled the 10K study event, and maybe 2 years ago or 3 years ago, I don't know, like 3 years ago maybe, I think it was a pot limit hold'em event that I final tabled. So
I think Joe
I play a bunch.
Didn't you finish 40th? Or so last year in the main event?
This year it was 180th, 180th I finished.
Wow.
Oh, 180th, I'm sorry. Okay, sorry.
Yeah, Mr. Devonshire, I lost with that overset.
Well, I have to say, I upped Joe on that because I finished 73rd once in the World Series main event. And that's when Jamie Gold won it, when there were over 8,000 entrants. So
wow,
I have that
really?
On Joe. Yeah, I have that on.
Yeah.
So are you guys both going to be playing a large quantity of tournaments this summer at the World Series?
Yeah, I for sure do. Like, usually during the World Series, I'll play like a full schedule. That's the only time and John's the same way. We both kind of buckle down and just play a month's worth of
Actually, I might cut down my tournament schedule this summer to focus more on cash. I've kind of neglected the side cash games in the World Series, and I heard they're really good. So primarily being a cash game player, I think I'm giving up too much of an edge just by foregoing all the cash games.
I was going to say, John, that the cash games during the WSOP are so juicy. You know, you'd wonder why you wouldn't just play those and, you know, stick to maybe the main event.
Exactly. Exactly. Your point is well taken. That's so, like, in the last 5-6 years, I've played almost no cash because I was playing, like, a heavy slate of World Series events. And it's taxing when you're playing an event every day. And even when you need to take days off, and it's still taxing playing 20, 25 events during the summer.
It sure
and
is.
There's so
much equity in the cash game tables that only is there during the WSOP. Those games are not available in Las Vegas any other time of the year, so you really got to take advantage of those games.
Yeah, exactly. So yeah, exactly. I think my approach this year is kind of cut down on tournaments. I mean, I'll still play a few, but I might put some hours into cash games as well.
Well, I mean, listen, guys, just from go ahead, Joe.
Oh, no. I mean, I'm usually too either tired or tilted after I finish the tournament that I just like don't. I'm done with the cash games. I don't even want to play. So.
Yeah, you just want to get home and relax. I understand.
Pretty much.
Just from this little conversation we're having right now, I think this is what is going to be great about this new show you guys are going to be doing. Is it's going to let us come into the minds of two brilliant poker players, and that's something that I really think the listeners are really going to enjoy, guys. This is going to be a lot of fun. What else do you guys see bring to the table for all the listeners?
I mean, the first and foremost, we're going to share a lot of strategic advice. And the thing is, Joe and I are on top of the games. And that's the thing. Some people haven't been able to transition well over the years because the landscape of poker always changes. So I think Joe and I are a rare breed in that we've always adapted to the games changing because we've always been successful year in, year out. And the games changed a lot. I remember when I came in 14 years ago, the games were pretty soft. And Joe might say the same thing when he came in 7-8 years ago. So, and the games got tougher, and we've always stayed ahead of the curve. So not only would we share how to play correctly, but we would also share, just like the proper mindset on how to succeed in the long run, because we've actually done it. We haven't been winning just for 1 or 2 years. We've been winning for numerous years. So, like the lifestyles.
To tell you, John, I had some tournament success in, maybe 06, 07, and then I took a while off and they played some tournaments, never had too much luck. But I concentrated more so on mixed games. And then, you know, maybe in 08, 09, I started struggling a little bit with my no-limit game. And John makes a good point, like how we both kind of stayed on top of the game. I mean, he's really always been on top of the game. He's always studying and learning, like, the newest thing. And I remember in, like, 09, I kind of struggled a little bit with the no-limit game. It was obviously when a lot of the good young players started coming in. And I was just, you know, I was talking to John, and we'd always discuss strategy and things like that. And I really had to change my no-limit game just totally. I mean, I never even realized it at first. I always thought, well, you know, because I did so good in tournaments, I always thought, well, yeah, I'm just running bad or something like that. You know, I had where I had a year or two of just bad runs, and I was like, well, you know, maybe I'm just running bad. And then I talked to John afterwards, and I'm realizing that the game was just so different. And I really had to, like, totally change my approach to no limit. I think earlier, like, I won just based on, a lot of it was based on luck, or a lot of it was based on the fact that other players were pretty bad at the same time, too. So, like, you know, even when I was earlier, 06, 07, like, I wasn't that good, but I don't think the other players were that good either, so.
Got it. John, how many hands have you played online, John?
Several million. It's funny because there is a 2+2 thread about who's played the most hands, and people are throwing bad guesses out, like Doyle Brunson or some live players.
Right.
And, you know, I probably played more hands than them in 1 year than they have in their lifetime, so like live hands and my online hands, so. I'd probably say I'm in the top 10, maybe top 5. I'm not 100% sure, but I would say at least 5 million hands online. Probably somewhere around 8 million.
And like you guys have been saying, you guys have been constantly changing your game, so you haven't been just sitting back and, you know, waiting for things to break down. You guys are constantly fixing them and working on them. Is that correct?
Yep, that's absolutely
correct. Yeah, exactly.
And
I can definitely vouch for how many hands John's played, too. I mean, he was a machine, I'll tell you. Like, I used to play maybe 4 to 6 tables at once, and John, I mean, he could do that with like, 2 eyes half closed. I mean, his eyes half closed, and just, I mean, 4 tables for him was nothing. I mean, it was amazing to watch, for sure.
Yeah, I mean, what was your how many hours a day did you play, John, and how many tables at a time?
To be honest, I think my biggest leak, if you want to call it a leak, was that I didn't play enough just because the money came so easily. And I also have a family, so
right.
I have an excuse for not putting in too much time. That's the other thing we talk about, too. I think we can provide valuable advice is how to balance your life. I mean, it's nice and all to be a poker player and play a lot of hours and make a lot of money, but Joe and I, another thing we've achieved success in is just having overall balance in our lives. I mean, we do a lot of other stuff besides poker, and I think it's really helpful when you play. But I think I averaged maybe 25 hours a week the past 4 or 5 years grinding online. But I was winning at such a high hourly rate, grinding 15 tables, like 5-10 tables, that's all I needed to play, and I was making really good money.
Wow. So were you an exclusive no-limit player when you played online?
90% no-limit. Like Joe said, too, he likes mixed games. I like every game except no-limit hold'em, believe it or not. But my earning
I'm the same way.
But my earning power is so great in no-limit, that's what I have to play. It's, you know, I treat it like a business. So, but I actually might have more fun playing tournaments or mixed games online than just strictly cash games.
That's great. Yeah,
when we were in Vegas, we'd always sit around and play, like, you know, small mixed games or whatever it is. Like, when we played together, we never played. It was never no limit, really.
Yeah, that's like John said, that's your business. And, you know, when you guys want to have fun and kick back, you play the mixed games. That's great.
Yeah.
Well, listen, guys, I just want to say, I want to thank you for coming on a week before we actually start this and kind of giving us a feel of what we're going to get. And I'm excited. I know that I'm going to definitely be tuning in, and I'm pretty sure that a lot of other people are going to be tuning in as well. So just like to thank you guys, and we'll see you guys next week.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you, Joe. Thank you, John. Any parting
words? Looking forward to it. We're very excited, and I'm definitely looking forward to it. So And I know Joe has always wanted to, you know, just share his wisdom with people, and I don't think he's really had a chance to
do that. The wisdom, I don't know. Sometimes it's good. Yeah, sometimes it's wisdom. I mean, I never, you know, I've had some bad,
ultimately, the fact is that Joe and I have been like two of the very most successful poker players over the past decade. And, you know, so some people might not realize that. It might sound like a brag, but it's just fact. And, you know,
right.
We're very happy to impart some of the stuff that we've learned over the years with our listeners.
No, I mean, yeah, this is what's amazing. And John, you used to host Cash Plays, right, back in the day?
That's correct.
So we're kind of just reviving it.
Right, exactly. So, and it was a very popular show, and a lot of people said it helped their games tremendously.
Well, that's what we want to do, guys. That's definitely what we want to do. And between now and next Wednesday, they can go to stack'emcoaching.com, and they can check out all your stuff there. I've been lost on that site, not lost and not knowing what to do, but I've just been looking at all the content. You guys have a ton of content, a lot of good stuff, a lot of good students, a lot of good coaches. And you even got Jared Tendler, who just finished his show before this one. So it's really good synergy there, too, as well, guys.
Yep, thanks.
Okay.
Yeah,
see you guys. See you guys next week. Enjoy the rest of your week, and I look forward to listening in to the first show, guys.
All right, thanks a lot.
Cool. All right, thank you.
Take care, guys.